Okay, thank you. So yes, the key word is quantum integrability, because about the classical Benjamin Ono equation, everything is known. There is nothing to add. So it's very well studied integrable equation, but the quantum case is just in the beginning of its study. So, где у меня вверх, где низ? Right, so to remind you what I'm speaking about. So in hydrodynamics, there is a bunch of equations describing waves or gravitational waves on the surface of water. So in historical sequence, the first one was Korteweg de Vries equation for the case of shallow water. Then Benjamin Ono equation in the opposite case of deep water, and then intermediate equation interpolating those as two limiting cases. It contains parameter delta, so when delta goes to zero, it gives KdV, delta goes to infinity, it gives Benjamin Ono. So all three equations share the same non-linearity, quadratic linearity in terms of, when we speak about equations of motion, and differ only by a linear dispersive term. So they have the common non-dispersive term, like in Professor Dubrovin talk, and they can be considered as different deformations of this hydrodynamic non-dispersive equations. So about those equations, everything, in the classical case, they studied very well, everything is known, all there is a hierarchy of integrals of motions, Backlund transformations, soliton solutions, inverse scattering problem, everything.
В уравнении последнем, дельта минус первый, и дальше фи, третья производная или первая?
Second.
Ну, вторая, нет, а там, предыдущая.
Тоже вторая. Один.
Не там, в предыдущем члене, фи x или фи xx?
Фи x, yes.
Джей, вот. Последнее уравнение есть
дельта
минус
1
фи x. Вот здесь 3x или 1?
Фи x, yes. Well, it's subtracting, so compensating for this term to take the limit when delta goes to infinity. Right. So, so in principle, intermediate ILW equation covers them all. So the question why to study Benjamin Ono. So the answer is I will explain it later. That the Benjamin Ono is an equation of entirely different class. So okay, I can explain it a little bit now. So in the let us write several examples of integrable systems. So one is, let's say, open order. So in terms of Hamiltonian, it's sum n1 to n, n particle order. So the momenta plus sum of exponent of qn minus so here sum from n 1 to n minus 1 qn plus 1. So open to the chain, then there is open closed periodic to the. So it's same plus exponent of qn minus qn capital minus q1. Then second equation is Kolodziejczyk-Sutherland equation. and same kinetic energy term plus sum of pair, let's say m less than n sine squared q m minus q n, and with some constant. And elliptic, elliptic Calogero, so here again same kinetic energy, but the potential is given by Weierstrass function. And then we can third. It's Calogero Sutherland. Calogero. Well, just to distinguish it from trigonometric Calogero. Physicists like to call it Calogero Sutherland. So elliptic Calogero. And Benjamin Ono and ILW. So my remark is that the first column is equations, they are all integrable, but the first column are equations of a very special kind. So what I mean?
And also there is this Rusinasa system, which
yes, of course, yes, that. Yes. It's kind of, but I don't have enough space on this. But for my to make my point, these examples are enough. So what is the difference between left hand, left column and right column? So the left column is, right column are just generic integrable systems. Integrable systems. And this observation is due to, actually Krichewer. He's gone already, but it's a pity. Krichewer and Vaninsky, that the left column are the equations with the rational spectral curve. Rational spectral curve. For example, in case of Toda, we have for the open Toda chain, we have on the diagonal Lax matrix momenta on the diagonal. Then, you can write here 1, 1, 1, the lower diagonal and exponent of, Q1, 2, Q1 minus Q2 exponent of Q2, 3, and exponent of Qn, n minus 1, n. So three diagonal Jacobian matrix. So this is Lax matrix for open Toda. So the generating function of the Hamiltonians is a spectral determinant of this matrix, Jacobian matrix. So the spectral invariance coefficients of this polynomial are spectral invariants. So what a periodic case is different is that we add two more elements here. We can add V times. So this Lax matrix does not contain spectral parameters. So for the periodic case, we introduce here Q n1 exponent of n1 and here just one according to this and here one over v exponent of qn1. So we perturb this matrix with perturbation of rank 2. So actually, if we omit, if we perturb it only with one term here and omit this, it will remain an open. So we have modified minus L minus V times one dimensional projector. So some some vector and covector. But it's well known that determinant there is a well known formula for perturbation of determinant with one dimensional projector. So the resulting spectral curve is linear in V, so that's why it's a rational spectral curve. But if we insert two terms here, then it's a perturbation of rank 2, and spectral curve will be not rational, but of genus 1 and hyper-elliptic term. So same applies to the all equation in the left column. So they all correspond to rational spectral curve. So what, and that the consequence is that, one may say that it's just the degenerate case of the generic integrable models, but actually it means that it means that actually one, the positive side is that it's not just part of particular case, but for the models with rational spectral curve, we have additional structures where we have properties that are absent for the models in the generic case. So in the this is for the classical case, and in the quantum case, one may say that it's not a theorem, just a conjecture from the examples that a generic integrable system corresponds to better ansatz, where the spectrum is determined by complicated systems of algebraic or even transcendental equations. But for the system classically having rational spectral curve, it seems that the quantum analog are all hypergeometric, so the spectrum is trivial, but they have additional richer structure. So, for example, all eigenfunctions can be constructed by explicit integral representations, like we take functions for Toda, and so on. So that's explain interest specifically for Benjamin Ono equation. So it's a hypergeometric, in the quantum case, it's hypergeometric equation, and having some, so on one hand, it's easier, much easier to solve that this more generic equation. And on the other hand, it's it has some additional rich structure. So another remark is that actually one can obtain all of these models from the second line. So open Toda chain is a limit of trigonometric collogeral model, periodic to the chain is a certain limit of elliptic Calogero modeling, the limit when the particles, they live on the circle of some radius, when the radius goes to infinity. They are separated very far, so asymptotically 1 over sine squared, its asymptotic tail is the exponent giving this. And the next, only the leading term is only nearest neighbor, so all the rest are higher order terms. And similar, more difficult for the
breaks the symmetry of
permutation. Yes. And also in the limit Benjamin Ono is in a sense a limit of Calogero Sutherland trigonometric when n goes to infinity. And there are indications there is a recent work of Shiraishi that in a sense intermediate long wave equation is a limit of elliptic Calogero, but the details are not yet clear, but there are strong numeric evidence. Right, so having said all that, when I speak about this limit from Calogero to Benjamin Ono, I'm speaking about periodic Benjamin Ono. So let us put periodicity conditions. So in the previous slide, it was on the line, real line from minus infinity to infinity. Now we introduce periodicity and introduce variable z on a unit circle, exponential variable. So we can speak of positive powers of z and negative powers of z, analytic inside the unit circle and outside of unit circle. So we can expand the field phi into Fourier series. And equations of motion in terms of this Fourier components, equations of motion takes the form like this. So we have quadratic terms and linear term corresponding to this particular dispersion law. So these equations of motion are Hamiltonian with this Hamiltonian cubic term nonlinear and quadratic corresponding to the linearity. So here equations of motion for P and bar just obtained for complex conjugate. And Poisson brackets are the following. But, so it's a collection of harmonic oscillators. And P zero is a central element. So it's safe actually to put P zero to zero because it all the integrals of motion it's just if P zero changes, it's just linear combinations of the same integrals of motion, so nothing new. So so now how we quantize? Well, the quantization is obvious. So since this bracket, Poisson bracket, is something like a canonical bracket, we can quantize it as a harmonic oscillator. So we introduce, we work in the space of polynomials of infinitely many variables. So polynomials means contains a finite number of terms. So the number of variables is infinite, of P1, P2, P2, etc. And we combine, we introduce generators of algebra, Heisenberg algebra by So for negative n, it's just multiplication by p, like creation operators. And for positive n, it's differentiation, it's like annihilation operators. So they form a well-known Heisenberg-Lie algebra. And the Hamiltonian is written like this. So it differs from the classical expression just by normal ordering. All the differentiations goes to the right. Right, now now a few words about this limit from Calogero to Benjamin Ono. So very quickly, so the Calogero Moser, well, Calogero Sutherland, if trigonometric Calogero we have, so I speak about the quantum case from the very beginning. So we have Hamiltonian, I wrote it here, but here it's again. So coupling constant beta, interaction of all particles, pairwise interactions by via inverse sine squared, and here it's momentum operator. So we after we do we make a few transformation, eliminate the vacuum factor, then go to the exponential variables, change parameter to alpha. So we have, and then we let n go to infinity. So after certain renormalizations, so we subtract this growing term, the result is the following. So the renormalized, so far, well, first we just subtract this term, so it's still for the finite number of particles, so we have this differential operator as Hamiltonian second order differential operator. So it acts in the space of symmetric polynomials, it's in eigenfunctions are well known, they are called Jack polynomials, they are studied again very well. So as and then we can let n go to infinity. So we subtract from the eigenvalue this growing factor. And then, but the problem is x, now we have infinite number of x's, and such expressions are not very convenient. So instead of x variables, we introduce, so here just some, to make it rigorous, we need to speak about stability of Jack polynomials. So if you restrict one of the variables to zero, you obtain Jack polynomials of n minus one particles. So then we can rigorously define what is the limit of Jack polynomials for infinite n. And after all, so the trick is to introduce so-called collective variables, as physicists they call, or as mathematicians call them, power sum symmetric function. So and to rewrite our Hamiltonian in terms of variables p. So then the calculation, the result is exactly the same Hamiltonian as we have for the Benjamin Ono equation. So when speaking about hydrodynamics, it's not very clear why should we quantize waves on the water, but this Hamiltonian, quantum Hamiltonian, it arises recently in various physical context, in solid state physics, and in
Benjamin Ono would have a finitely many.
No. Benjamin Ono is infinitely many variables.
It's a local potential, but
it's a field of X. So I P are its Fourier components, infinitely many. Yes, of course. So it arises in.
So it means that these are not the same
P as. No, these are just the moment conjugated to Q, so I can to distinguish them, let it be P, and this P are symmetric functions.
So Benjamin Ono basically is already a field theorem.
Yes, from the very beginning.
Once the other ones were quantum mechanics.
Yes, But as we let n go to infinity in the Kolodziej resonant, we can obtain
Benjamin. So if you know how to solve elliptic Kolodziej Moser, then you would solve in this limit a field theoretic.
Yes, but we don't know how to solve. Well, you know, I don't know.
What do you mean? It's a fact.
Yes.
There is a similar version for others. Let's say for sine Gordon, you cannot tell the sine Gordon. There is no system where you can take the limit and get other field theoretic models like, I don't know, nonlinear shielding or sine.
I don't know. Well, so
it's only Belgium and Ono is a field theoretic model which has this nice limit from the quantum.
Yes, it's a hypergeometric. No, there are claims, Shiraishi, that also you can obtain from elliptic Kolodziej.
Yes, if you want to get, let's say, some other field theoretic model, like
yes.
Sinch-Gardon.
No, this is not a hypergeometric model. So what I'm going to speak about is is applied only to the left column, so I have nothing to say about right.
Well, the spin model, just as far as spin.
Right, but it's not a quantum mechanical. But it's not a quantum; it's a lattice model.
Okay, so
quantum many body system, which in the limit gives you a field theoretic good problem, and then he says only one example is Benjamin. Please.
Can I continue?
Yes.
Right. So we have so this Hamiltonian arises recently in solid state physics, in conformal field theory, and also with in Zakunikov Panharipande. They studied it in relation to quantum cohomologies. I can't comment. I don't know anything about quantum cohomologies. Just it justifies my presence here.
Yeah. Result
of that term. This is exactly the kind of term. Right. So now about what the main content of my talk, our results with Maxim Nazarov. So, okay, I have time. I started exactly at.
You started at 10.
All right. So as I said, in the classical case, everything is known, so there is little to add. But for the quantum case, so the first question is what are the higher commuting Hamiltonians for this? So these are just first two members of hypothetical commuting hierarchy. So is there any way to write down explicitly the higher commuting Hamiltonians quantum? And the answer is positive, and even we can do it in two completely different ways. So the first way is based on the fact that for Kolodziej-Rosazelland or for Jack polynomials, we know the differential commuting differential operators are given by Sekiguchi or Debyar. Formula, so all we need is to take a limit to n going to infinity. So for the first approach is to take the known quantum integrals of motion for Kolodziej-Rosazelland or for Jack polynomials and somehow let n go to infinity and rewrite it in terms of in terms of some symmetric polynomials. Okay, so this seems duplication. Well, so this is just same Hamiltonians in terms of quantum field phi, so with normal ordering. So this is so finally. So this is Hamiltonian in terms of phi with periodic Hilbert transform, which is just a difference of two projectors on the
functions analytic inside unit circle and outside. So the zero, there is a constant term. So unlike the Hilbert transform for the functions on the line, in the periodic case, there is a special zero mode. So we are just we just erase this zero mode, and further I.
This looks more similar to the operator that enters into intermediate long wave expression.
No, it's no for the intermediate long waves. This operator will be elliptic function. Because it's already hyperbolic cotangent on the whole line. So if you add periodicity, it will be yes, double periodic function, so it will be elliptic function. But I concentrate from now.
Take the Lagrangian limit of the Jack Holly number.
Yes, I will.
If you would do that for just the character.
No, the polynomials are just eigenfunctions. I want to describe the differential operators that are diagonal on these eigenfunctions. That was not known before us. Well, there were some constructions, again, by Shiraishi in terms of vertex operator, but not very very explicit.
So you mean that each one needs to address the beginning of the
yes.
Of this sequence of
yes. So now I'm going to present the higher Hamiltonians and describe
I was
them.
Wondering why each one? Because each one is not.
Yes, sure. Okay, so here just some remarks. So okay, so here, so we start. Right, we start with Calogero Sutherland n particles, n is finite, so then our starting point is this so-called Sakiguchi Debier determinant. So in classical case, it's just a matrix similar to the Lux operator, but it's a bit transformed. So. You can't immediately recognize it. It needs some work. So this determinant. So this, despite the fact that the entries of this matrix are operators, the determinant is well defined because the rows commute with each other. So each row depends on the variable with index j. So determinant is well defined, and the proof of that it's this operator are diagonal on the Jack polynomials is based on the triangularity argument. So Jack polynomials are triangular with respect to the standard. A standard ordering of partitions, and these operators are one can show that acting on a monomial symmetric functions, we get monomial symmetric functions and lower order. So it's triangular. On the other hand, it's self-adjoint with respect to certain scalar products, so it's both symmetric and triangular, so it's diagonal. That's it. So, and eigenvalues, so since it's triangular, you can just take as eigenvalue, it's diagonal matrix elements that are very easy to...
J lambda the Jack polynomial.
Yes. J lambda Jack polynomials and labeled lambda is a partition of n of length n. So okay, so then we to Well, first we can't immediately go let n go to infinity in this formula. Looking at eigenvalues, we see that we have infinite product, so we need to regularize it. So we regularize it by dividing by the vacuum factor, so when all lambda are zero. So we introduce divide it by its vacuum factor. It's a programmer symbol. Then, so here's some stability argument. So then, when n goes to infinity, these eigenvalues have good limit because all the a partition is so every partition has only a finite number of elements, so it's lambda 1, lambda 2, greater or equal lambda 3, and so on up to some lambda n, and then all the rest are zero. So when dividing by vacuum factor, all those factors cancel, so we have a finite expression for the eigenvalue. All right, so eigenvalues are very nice, but it's not the point. The point is to get an expression for this operator in terms of, how it acts on the polynomials. Okay, so to this end, we expand it into such a series according to the denominators. So not in a power series, but with this shifted factorials. So then we claim that we know the formula for these operators, for this commuting Hamiltonians. Well, for it's easy to compute, so these are polynomial combinations of H1, H2, but what about higher ones? So here's...
H1, H2 are the previous ones.
Yes. So it's just expressed polynomially. When the order grows, it becomes more and more complicated. So it's not a good idea. So here's to describe the answer. So we introduce some combinatorial coefficients for partitions. So p functions are orthogonal with respect to such a scalar product. They form orthogonal basis with such normalization. The answer is written in terms of monomial symmetric functions. We that are obtained from for given some partition lambda, we form product x1 lambda 1, x2 lambda 2, etc. until the last member of the partition, then extended symmetrically to all x. So these are symmetric functions. They form a basis that one of the well-known basis for standard basis for symmetric functions. It can be expanded in P and in Jack polynomials, some standard simple basis. And the result is quite amazing. So here's the formula for these higher Hamiltonians. So here, d lambda are just some combinatorial coefficients in terms of the component of partitions multiplicities. K1 is multiplicity of 1, etc. So M lambda is operator of multiplication by lambda, and M lambda star is chemically conjugate operator with respect to this scalar product. So if you wonder where is the coupling constant alpha, it's hidden in this star.
But the Jack polynomial depends on alpha.
Yes, so and this conjugation depends on alpha. So these are, in terms of P, these are differential operators including alpha. But in this form, it's hidden. So it also means that in the classical limit, the result is given exactly by this formula. It seems that this is unknown formula for the classical, yes. Well, the problem is this M are not P, so they don't commute as free. So this formula is very, very beautiful, but quite mysterious. We don't have any explanation, just as a matter of fact. So the proof is going well. So in principle, okay, it would be nice to express in terms of P, but the problem P can be expressed in terms of M, but the connection matrix is rather combinatorial complicated object. So these operators in terms of original variables P are not nice. But amazingly, so in principle, we can choose any basis and write such a quadratic form, but it won't be diagonal. So only in the basis of M, it becomes diagonal for some mysterious reason. So the proof is rather...
But still then, algebra generated by M and M star will be have linear right inside. Yeah?
No, M star are polynomials in P, so it's a higher order differential operators.
But you said that M star was conjugate to lambda.
M
was multiplication by lambda. Right?
Yes, and M star is a conjugate of M lambda.
So it commutes on
It's a differential operator. Yes. A differential operator in P with constant coefficients.
But lambdas are not orthogonal. M lambda is not orthonormal basis.
M lambda? No, not at all. And the summation, interestingly, is taken over all partitions having exactly k lines. Not so usually in combinatorics you have inequality, but here it's exactly k lines, not more nor less. So this gives us a formula for the Hamiltonian of order k.
Whether the sum is well defined?
Yes. So on all polynomials, it's all higher terms are zero. If you apply this expression to a polynomial, so only finite number of terms survive.
Yes.
So.
Until lambda k equals zero.
Sorry.
You can have lambda k equals zero, and it should be still in the sum. So it's intrinsically less or equal.
Well, but the point where we want to expand it in this basis to have nice eigenvalues. So we have this expansion, yes. So. Okay, AK are coefficients at special functions depending with a nice dependence on U. So that, yes, of course, you can rearrange it, but then you lost this. Okay, so this. Okay, so this is one result. Now it was a year ago. Now some fresh.
Can you say something about wave functions?
Huh?
Wave functions.
any in this limit some what happens?
It's Jack polynomials of infinitely many variables. It's well,
infinitely many variables.
Yes.
And on the right hand side, nothing.
Nothing. I don't speak about right hand side. So this is first result. Now second result is. So it's based on the constructions of integrals of motion for the classical case. So in the classical case, all integrals of motion, of course, are well known, but usually it's very rarely it helps to construct integrals of motion in the quantum case, where I know that the quantization problem can be quite non-trivial. But here, fortunately, the deformation, the quantum deformation is done rather easy. So now again, so in the generic case, when we have a Lux matrix, we take determinant, spectral determinant, or its logarithmic derivative is a trace of resolvent. So, and the coefficients are the commuting Hamiltonians. However, for the systems with the rational spectral curve, there are some alternative formula. This alternative formula that is that instead of a trace that may be divergent if we have infinite matrix unbounded operators, so we have to go into trouble to regularize it. So instead of this, we have let us say it's I of U. Instead of we take again resolvent of the Lux operator, but instead of taking trace, so infinite sum, we take some. We take a matrix element between a pair of vectors. So again, rank one projection. So for the systems with rational spectral curve, again, it's not a theorem, it's just observation from examples. So for all the systems in the left column, there exists such a pair of vectors that the integrals of motion, instead of taking trace, we just take one matrix element. For example, well, for Toda, it's just this projector on this for Calogero-Sutherland, it's just a pair of column made of all units and its conjugate. And for Benjamin Ono, here it is. So in the classical case, it's not new, it's all known. So, but let me now present you the quantum result. So let us take instead of A, the ratio A over A plus one. So kind of a logarithmic finite difference derivative. And then we say and introduce H in this way. So it's another rearrangement of the same Hamiltonians. So now I'm going to present the formula for this H of this sort. So we introduce, so again, well, we can think of H as a series. So now I expanded not in Pohammer symbols, but in a just a simple power asymptotic series or formal series. Well, then well H are expressed as this. So here the key ingredient is the Lax matrix. So it's a semi-infinite matrix and very simple. So on the diagonal we have alpha minus 1 times 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. And here we have the nearest diagonal is P1, then the next diagonal is P2, P3, and conjugated on the... So it's a matrix with quantum operators. So these are quantum operators. So let me... So in the so this matrix right so this matrix comes from the known results for the classical Benjamin Ono. In the classical Benjamin Ono, alpha is zero, so we have just minus. So if we think of this operator as acting on the columns F, F1, F2, F3, and identify them with analytic vectors, so again eliminating zero mode, so we consider such vectors, so just a Taylor series with coefficients F. Then in the classical Benjamin Ono, the Lax operator is well, pseudo-differential operator that makes from F. So this diagonal term corresponds to minus Z dZ F. So obviously it gives N on the diagonal. And the rest is, so we have a differential operator perturbed with a Toeplitz matrix. And this Toeplitz matrix corresponds just to multiplying F by phi and truncating the series to the positive powers of Z. So I write it like plus part. So this is
the other side.
It's all here. Phi contains both positive and negative. And since the matrix is semi-infinite, we have to truncate it. So this is the classical result, but, and amazingly, all we need to do for the quantization is just to add this alpha here. So it was done just experimentally. And so this is the classical result, yes. So in the quantum case, just one minus alpha here, or alpha minus one. Alpha minus one.
Classical limit is alpha equals zero.
Yes, yes. So experimental result was that all we needed just to change the diagonal slightly. Well, after that, we managed to prove it rigorously. So, so it's not a conjecture, it's a theorem. So it's a Lax operator now about these two projectors. They are very simple. So here, okay, so, right, so we just introduce, so here, this resolved and two vector column and vector row. So just P1, P2 and conjugated. So this very simple formula for this. So note there that since L mixes P and P star, so it's not a normally ordered expression. So you just need to So the first two are normally ordered, but higher Hamiltonians obtained from this formula are not normally ordered. But nevertheless, well, this is exact result. So and they expressed through the previous function A by the formula. By the formula I gave is a of u divided by a of u plus 1. Well, few remarks about the proof. The proof is based on on an analog of the Baker Heiser vector for the rational spectral curve. So we introduce some column by this formula. So we just eliminate from this, so we erase this left factor here, and so we have some column vector and multiply it by a of u plus 1. So in many respects this object plays the same role as the Baker-Heiser function for the rational spectral curve. So from this, so it satisfies nice equation, and from which we can prove the necessary identity. So we can expand it, we expand it in terms of this shifted factorials. So what we need to prove is this identity. So we can find the explicit formula for this psi function. So such psi functions they are used in algebraic, in classical case in algebraic geometry. They are constructed in the terms of theta functions, but for rational spectral curve, it's just a rational function. So it's something. It was inspired by Krychewiere and Vaninsky work for open Todd chain. So they also they studied what happens with the spectral curve of the open of the periodic Toda in this limit. So all the so it's two-sheeted Riemannian surface. All the but in this limit when we get open to Toda chain, all the cuts collapse into points. So we have just two Riemannian complex plane glued in a finite number of points. So here, this is I don't just I don't go into details that are not very clear. But what we needed to prove this theorem we did. So the expressions for the coefficients psi are very similar to the expressions for A. They are also in terms of monomial functions and elementary symmetric polynomials. So in terms of the very basic objects you can find in Mark Donald's book in the first few pages. So and this is operator adjoined to this elementary symmetric function. And based on this formula, what we need to prove for the formula for H generative function H of u gives us the integrals of motion. It's reduced to some combinatorial relations between monomial and elementary symmetric functions. So it's just a bunch of simple polynomial relations. So this is the idea of the proof. Do I have how much time? 2 minutes. All right, so very...
Psi and K is an operator.
А psi is an operator. Yes. It's a yes, but it's a quantized, yes, quantized Baker-Heiser function. Yes, so well, something object, well, like, well, well, the theory of quantum spectral curves is now very hot, so it's something of the quantum rational spectral curve. All right, so then we have also we have shifting operators for this Jack polynomial. So we, so if we we have A of U, if we commute it with P1, we introduce operator B, and with conjugated did we introduce operator C. And this B and C, they can be used as creation annihilation operator for Jack polynomials. Not the way the works Vinel Lapointe, but they constructed quite a different kind, or Kirillov Noumi, they constructed a different kind of so this creation annihilation shift polynomials are more in the style of Beta Ansatz or of well, for separation of variables. So so first we have the say similar expression in terms of monomial functions, just since it's operator adding degree, so we have just right here one unit in the bottom of the Young tableau. And similarly for C is just conjugated. And then they act in a very nice way on the Jack polynomial. So for Jack polynomials, there are known combinatorial coefficients for multiplication by P1 and differentiation. That's some explicit formula. So it's a linear combination over all partitions mu, where we add one cell into each of the possible places. And then we have eigenvalues of A, and from this we construct, well, so these operators act in a very simple way. So we can, so if we specialized the parameter u to this value, we can just add a cell to the Jack polynomial into any prescribed position. So if we have a Jack polynomial corresponding to the diagram lambda and select the row number I, which is of length lambda I, then this operator B of this value adds this just creates Jack polynomials with one cell added to exact place. And continuing, we can start from the vacuum and construct all Jack polynomials in this way.
You see creation and annihilation operators.
Yes.
You see our annihilation.
Yes. Yes. So it's also where I can erase a cell in a precise spot. Well, and also there are generalization to MacDonald polynomials. So far we have only generalization of the first formula. Instead of A, so here they are D. So instead of M, where we have P and Q, where P are now not monomial symmetric functions, but the so-called whole Littlewood polynomials. And Q is another, again, same whole little polynomials in a different normalization. So they are simpler than Magnon polynomials. Magnon polynomials have two parameters, Q and T, and whole little word only one parameter. So in this formula, they replace the, yes, I'm about to finish. So they replace the monomial function. So a little bit more complicated formula, but still manageable and provable. About Lax operator in the Magnon case, we don't know yet. So there is no doubt that the Lax matrix exists, but it's certainly more complicated than for Jack polynomials. So such a simple, so Lax matrix, there is a classical analog of Benjamin Ono equation deformed. So in the McDonald case, instead of differential operator, there is a finite difference operator. But and Lax matrix is known as the classical case, but the quantization rule seems to be more complicated than in Jack case. So in Jack case, it's well, we are very lucky that the formula is so simple. So we believe, we are quite sure that the Lax operator for McDonald polynomials exists, but it ought to be formulated in terms of not in terms of P, but in terms of this whole Littlewood polynomials. That's a bit nuisance. All right. So I stress here that I only spoke about this hypergeometric models. For people like Samson, they may despise them because the good more interesting perhaps is this generic integrable models, but still I insist that the hypergeometric systems or rational spectral curves, they have their own interest, because besides the things we have generically, they have their own beauties, their own devices that are absent for generic case. And also, these hypergeometric systems are important for the separation of variables method, because the separation of variables consists we expand eigenfunctions of one system into another one, and this second one must be simpler than the first one, and simpler means hypergeometric. So there are some hopes to use them for separation of variables as well. Okay, thank you. Sorry for being late. Yes.
Yeah, you said in the beginning that the long wave has two limits, which is
yes.
Cocked over KdV on one side and
yes.
Bo on the other
yes.
side. Is there a kind of symmetry which extends Bo and KdV?
No, KdV is not hypergeometric. Only Benjamin Ono is hypergeometric.
No. No,
KdV is about as complicated as generic case.
You mentioned this Chernyk algebra.
Yes.
A lot of talks, I think, in Stony Brook. So I think it was Upsov.
Yes, it's ABC operators. They kind of, as Maxim taught me, is Youngian of GL1.
Something
like
that.
Such like that. Yes.
Just a question about references. On some of the slides, I have seen just flashed the name, the reference to the paper by Eliasberg, 2002. It's just.
It's for the case of fermion, free fermion case, where it's purely non-dispersive.
Not
dispersive. Okay, and Eliasberg is not clear. It's the paper from the references from the paper of Rossi, And Rossi writes as a private communication, and as I understand it, goes back to Погребков. So who was the first, Eliashberg or Погребков? I'm not sure.